You know, and when we started planning the symposium, one thing we knew we wanted to talk about was the way that we assess the value of genomics technologies and highlight the work of experts who are pioneering new frontiers in health technology assessment. As we searched high and low, we became aware of a recognition program at the Canadian Agency for Drugs and Technologies in Health that awards leaders in HTA. And as we reviewed the list, there was one person that stood out on a list of many greats, and as fate would have it, the person who I have the high honor of introducing today. Dr. Sterling Bryan is a university-based health economist with extensive experience engaging with the policy and decision-making world. He began his career in the UK with appointments at St. Thomas Hospital Medical School and then Brunel University before moving to the University of Birmingham. His research track record shows a long-standing goal of informing policy and practice, demonstrated in part through extensive engagement with the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence. For many years, he led the University of Birmingham team that conducted economic analysis for NICE and served as a member of the NICE Technology Appraisals Committee. In 2005, he was awarded the Commonwealth Fund Harkness Fellowship and spent 1 year at Stanford University researching technology coverage decision-making in U.S. healthcare organizations. He immigrated to Canada in 2008, taking on the roles of professor in the University of British Columbia School of Population and Public Health and director of the Center for Clinical Epidemiology and Evaluation. Dr. Bryan is a strong advocate for patient-oriented research. He now partners with patients in all research activities. This year, Dr. Bryan became the president of BC Academic Health Science Network, which includes oversights of its operational units, the BC Support Unit, Clinical Trials BC, and Research Ethics BC.
Great, thank you very much indeed for that introduction, and and thank you very much for the invitation to present. So I'm going to talk about a particular piece of work that is happening in British Columbia in Canada, which is looking at clinical implementation of pharmacogenomics, particularly in the context of drug treatments for people with major depression. Next slide, please. So this piece of work is funded by three agencies. Genome Canada, our national funder of genome-based research, Genome BC, which is our provincial funder, and the provincial health research agency, the Michael Smith Foundation. Next slide, please. So the core team of people working on this project is extensive, and I think reflects the extent to which this piece of work is seen as being an important piece for policymaking in a provincial context in Canada. What I would point out, so Janine Austin is the co-lead. She and I are the leads for this project. So we have three patient partners as members of our team. So this underscores, I think, the work that we're doing now to fully incorporate and include patient partners as members of research teams. And we have people from a pharmacogenomics background, clinical practice, administrative data, knowledge translation, modeling and review work. Next slide, please. So the key issues that we're addressing in this work is, as I said, it's for people with mental health conditions. And we recognize that finding a medication that works without side effects is often a matter of trial and error. And so we want to do better than that. And obviously pharmacogenomics provides the possibility that we can do better than that. Recognizing the low concordance or compliance is associated with poorer health and potentially increased system costs. So pharmacogenomics can, in some situations, indicate whether a drug's likely to be effective and safe without adverse reactions. And that's fundamentally, like, the question is, should we be moving in that direction? So next slide, please. So the research question being addressed by this piece of work, which is a two-year project, is what is the effectiveness and the cost effectiveness of introducing pharmacogenomic testing in British Columbia as a routine component of clinical practice in the care of people with major depression? So it's a focused piece of work looking at people who have a diagnosis of major depression. Next slide, please. So the foundational components of the project are, it's based on reviewing existing literature. So this is not a project that is collecting primary data. It's going to be synthesizing and reviewing existing literature. But we can, and I'll talk about this briefly, access clinical data, and we can access administrative data in BC through the provincial data systems. There's a development, the second major component is the development of a major depression policy model for BC. And what I describe this as is the analytic infrastructure to support policy development in this clinical area. So the major depression policy model for BC that we're developing will be able to address the question of should we introduce pharmacogenomics in this clinical field, but then potentially can support improvement work in the field of major depression more generally. And then we have a framework and a knowledge translation strategy. Next slide, please. So this is these are the core activities of the work. So our initial activities, we started this work 1st of April this year, and as I said, it's going on for 2 years. So we've recruited our patient partners as part of activity one, and we've engaged in with key stakeholders as part of activity one already, and we're in the process of doing interviews with both patients and with key stakeholders. Activity two is the environmental scan and systematic review work, and that is all, that has been commenced as well. Activity three is the centerpiece, if you like, of this work, is the simulation model development. So this policy model development, and that'll be the basis for conducting a model-based economic analysis. As I indicated, we have administrative data that we can access in BC, and so activity four is going to be based on accessing administrative data. So for example, we can, every drug that is prescribed in BC, we can link to an individual patient. And we've got data that we can access that will give us a clear sense of what the current situation is in terms of sequencing of drugs in BC. So which drugs, if people have a diagnosis of major depression, which drug do they typically receive first? And we can actually look at the range of drugs that people receive as first line, second line, et cetera, and the timing of the administration of those drugs. So we've got rich data on current practice, if you like, in prescribing of drugs for people with major depression in a British Columbia context. And then activity five is the stakeholder engagement. So this work is all about trying to inform policy. And we'll put all of this together into a multi-stakeholder dialogue event that will have some recommendations that come from it, which might relate to implementation of the technology, might relate to further research being required. Next slide, please. So the background, if you like, and just putting this paper forward as a piece that I co-authored a couple of years ago, which we wanted to challenge people to think differently about the way that economic evaluation in healthcare and HTA is conducted. And the basic sort of message is that we should be thinking about a pathway model. So we should be focusing on a clinical area and trying to drive improvements in a clinical area. And then we see the role of technology coming into that. Rather than starting with the technology, we start with the desire to improve the efficiency of care delivery in a given clinical area. So that's the approach that we're taking here. Next slide, please. So the pathway modeling that we're developing for this for major depression is really a pathway that follows people from the point of initial diagnosis all the way through their care trajectory. And there are many, many interventions that obviously are available for people who have that diagnosis. Drug therapy is one of the major ways, obviously, of managing major depression, but it's not the only way of managing major depression. So in the pathway, we want to think about the use of non-drug technologies as well as drug technologies. And obviously we're putting a spotlight here on the question of pharmacogenomics, but we've also previously, for example, been asked to look at the place of psychotherapy in the care for patients with a diagnosis of major depression. So the clinical pathway is defined as a sequence of use of alternative health technologies. So that's like, do we start with psychotherapy, for example, once someone has this diagnosis, or do we move straight for drug therapy? Would be a sort of a simple way of thinking about that. Critically, is that we need to try and overlay the natural history into the model, because obviously we want to see whether people. What happens to people if they don't receive therapy, and then like what is the benefit of receiving therapy, and then the additional benefit of actually more effective therapy. In order to answer those questions, we need to understand the natural history of the condition. And then the pathway modeling becomes the foundation of the health technology assessment activity. It actually provides the infrastructure by which we can actually robustly answer questions about the effectiveness and cost effectiveness of interventions in that pathway. Obviously, drawing on data that's been published in clinical trials, data from other sources. So it's a way of synthesizing data, but it places it into the jurisdictional context, which is what we're doing here. So this is a pathway that's is specifically in a British Columbia context. Next slide, please. So this is just, like, I don't expect you to read this, it's just to give you a visual of the sort of pathways that we're talking about. So this is just relating to the drug therapy piece, and we've got an acute phase, and then we've got a maintenance phase that we're modeling. We've got adverse events that might happen, for example, depending on which drugs are being provided. And all of this is probabilistic. All of this is based on the best data that we can draw from literature, as well as working closely with clinical teams in order to define what are pathways that we typically see in British Columbia, as well as then overlaying data that we've got from British Columbia that can actually tell us what is the most likely use of drugs. So in this instance, this is before we've introduced pharmacogenomics as an option. And obviously we would expect to see different proportions of patients moving down different arms as we have more effective ways of targeting therapy. Next slide, please. So the pathway modeling, I think I use the language of supporting resource stewardship. And I think that's fundamentally where I think we're trying to go in a British Columbia context or a Canadian context, where we're trying to have an open conversation about resource scarcity and actually bring stakeholders to the table who are interested in driving improvements in a clinical area. So in this instance, we're bringing stakeholders together who have an interest in driving improvements in the care delivery in the clinical field of major depression. And what all of the stakeholders that we bring together have as a recognition to start with is that we've got limited capacity to introduce new technology. So we want to make sure we can use those resources well, and we want to drive as much improvement in care and as much improvement in health as we can for the clinical population. So the pathway model development has the engagement of, and therefore the ownership by, key stakeholders. So we've got clinical leaders around the table, we've got policy folks, we've got patients fundamentally, as well as analysts and in fact industry as well. And the proposed changes to any clinical pathway then get evaluated using this pathway model. Next slide, please. So this is just sort of, I guess, like just giving you a sense of who we have involved in this sort of process. So as I've indicated, we're working closely with clinical leaders and care teams. So these are people who, you know, spend their days providing care for people with major depression, and they don't just do that themselves, but they're in positions of leadership and influence within the provincial healthcare system. We've got patients. Fundamentally, we bring patients in to work closely with us. And in fact, the modeling that we're doing, the pathways that we're now defining as part of the model, have been influenced in large part by the experience of patients who we're bringing in as members of our research team. We're working and building relationships with policy folks at the very beginning of this work, so that we're defining the work and making sure that the work is seen as being of relevance directly and supportive of decision-making. This is obviously largely reimbursement decision-making in a provincial context, and we've got analysts, and we would also want to bring industry. We're not working at the moment with manufacturers of pharmacogenomics, but that's certainly something that we're open to. Next slide, please. So just to conclude, so decisions to adopt pharmacogenomics in British Columbia are being discussed. So I don't want to like overclaim this. I'm not saying that we're actually, this work is going to be directly leading to an adoption decision around pharmacogenomics in British Columbia. But what we're doing is actually bringing people together for a conversation and a discussion, which is a multi-stakeholder improvement partnership. So with resource stewardship as the sort of like key piece in this. And we're drawing on high quality evidence. So we're doing systematic reviews, making sure that we're aware of all of the high quality evidence and synthesizing that in the context of the pathway model, which will be the analytic infrastructure that we then can use in order to provide guidance on adoption in this provincial context. And next slide, please. So I'll just say a thank you again to the funders of the work, Genome Canada, Genome British Columbia, and the Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research. If you're wanting to connect with me, then my email address is there, and I'd be happy to be part of the open forum for discussion subsequently. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sterling.